Today's sermon title, The Healing Ministry. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord, our God, we thank you for your word in scripture, and we thank you for the wonderful acts of Jesus. We thank you for his healing ministry. Help us, O Lord, to learn. Help us, O Lord, to receive in order that we might heal, and in order that we might be healed, and in order that we might enable the healing of others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's go to the scripture. Mark chapter 1. It's wonderful when you turn in your Bibles, if you're able. Sometimes we may not be able to see the print, but if you're able. The healing ministry of Jesus. You know, when I was a kid and I read the Bible and I read about all these healings, I said to myself, what happened? Why not now, you know? Maybe you've asked the same question. The healing ministry of Jesus. Mark chapter 1 from verse 32. That evening, at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door. My professor in college said, impossible. And the whole city was gathered around the door. It's just a way of saying there were a whole lot of people outside that house. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And immediately you can notice some qualifications. It doesn't say he cured all, you know. Whereas it said the whole city was gathered. He cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. The healing ministry of Jesus was based on the understanding that body and mind are related. They're interrelated. You know that, don't you? Can I see hands? So we're affirming something we already know. But sometimes we need to reaffirm certain things so that we can take advantage of it and experience the healing in our own lives. You notice this in many of the healing miracles. Mark 2:5. The story of the man let down through the roof, a part of the roof was removed, so they let the paralyzed man down. And there was a big discussion about the authority of Jesus to forgive sins. Because before he healed the man, the first thing he said was, son, your sins are forgiven. Back then, it was felt that there's a relationship between sin and illness. And in order for this man to be healed, it was necessary to forgive sins. As I speak, I remember all kinds of things, and I got to be careful to not tell too many stories. The Western doctor who went to Africa and found that his medicines weren't working. And the shaman of the village said, it's because you don't have a certain twig branch over your door. So the Western doctor went out, got a twig, put it over his door. And from then, the medicine began to work. Sounds crazy. Body and mind are closely related. So Jesus first forgave, brought forgiveness of sin to the man. And then he said to him, stand up, take up your mat, and go home. The man was healed, he took his mat, and went his way. You're familiar with the story of the woman who touched the hem of his garment. Jesus said to her, when she revealed herself as the one who had touched his garment, he said, your faith, daughter, your faith has healed you. And thus, forgiveness of sin, faith. We see the connection as the basis, or one of the basis of the healing ministry of Jesus. There was also his authority and power because of his divinity. And that perhaps explains why we don't see a lot of those miracles today. But it still happens. because there is still that connection between body and mind, and we must recognize it. Let me tell you about the way I experienced it with my mom. I like to get down here to tell some of my stories. When I was in my 20s, one night my mother woke me up. She said, "Boy, take me to the hospital. I'm not well." So I took her to the hospital. Her blood pressure was sky high. I don't even remember the figures. 200 and something over 100 and something. The doctor said, "Raise your right arm." She raised it. "Raise your right leg." She raised it. "Raise, you know." He couldn't believe she did not have a stroke. He admitted her to the hospital immediately. I arranged for my mother to have a nice private room. I wanted the best for my mother. She spent 2 months in hospital before her pressure went back to normal. Thank God she went home and all was well. But about 6 months later, the same thing happened again. She woke me up in the middle of the night. "Boy, come take me to the hospital. I'm not well." Again, the pressure sky high, 200 over, 200 and something over 100. Again, the same test, "Raise your right arm. Raise your right leg." You know, and again, the doctors admit she hasn't got a stroke. He admitted her, but this time there were no private rooms available. So they put her in an open ward with lots of beds of patients. And every day I would go to see her as usual. On the third day, she said to me, "Boy, go home and bring my clothes. I'm discharged." The third day, I said, "Mommy, you've only been here 3 days." She said, "Yes, but I'm fine. The doctor says there's no reason for me to remain." I said, "But Mommy, how? Last time it was 2 months, now it's 3 days." She said, "When I look around here," mind you, she's in this open ward with all the sick people. She said, "When I look around here and I see all these sick people, I realize I'm not so badly off." And my pressure went right down. I never forgot that. That was the way I was struck by the relationship between body and mind. And we have to keep this in mind as we look at the many miracles in the Gospels, the many healings by our Lord Jesus Christ, and realize that it can be for our benefit in order that we too might experience healing.